Hello, everyone, and welcome to another excitingly high-tech episode of The Atheist Experience. I'm your host, Russell Glasser, and with me today is Martin Wagner. Today is Sunday, December 13th. We are a live call-in public access atheist television show based in Austin, Texas. Thanks to our live internet stream, we take calls from all over the world, but special preference is given to those people calling from inside the Austin area or theists calling from anywhere to disagree with something that we've said. Mm-hmm. The Atheist Experience is sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. You can find out more by visiting www.atheist-community.org, and when you do, be sure to check out our fact page for answers to frequently asked questions that we receive on the show. This show is live every Sunday from 4:30 to 6 o'clock p.m. Central Time on Austin Access Channel 10. If you'd like to watch us live from outside of Austin, you can certainly do that simply by visiting the official Atheist Experience website, www.atheist-experience.com, and then you click on Live Stream at the top of the page. And if you do that, you can also participate in a chat room during the show. Also, on that website, you can find audio and video video from past episodes. If you click on Archive, you will find a list of programs that includes links to the audio and video downloads. You can catch fan-selected clips of The Atheist Experience on YouTube, and you can also see full episodes of the show at blip.tv. Or you can listen on your favorite music device when you subscribe to our free audio podcast. In addition to this program, the ACA also sponsors a bi-weekly internet audio podcast called The Nonprofits. Visit www.nonprofitsradio.com, P-R-O-P-H-E-T-S, that's the address right there on your screen, for more information. The Nonprofits has been on hiatus for a couple of months now, but be sure to tune in next week on Saturday, December 19th for a special end-of-the-year episode. Weekly meetings for the Atheist Community of Austin are hosted at Romeo's on Barton Springs Road from 11:30 to 1 every Sunday except for the first Sunday of the month when we host our lecture series at the Austin History Center located at the corner of 9th and Guadalupe. The next lecture will be held, I did not write that down before the show.
Sunday of January, so.
For the next Sunday, yes. I mean, the first Sunday of January. Not next Sunday. threw up my group. If you can't make it to the morning meetings, you can always join us for dinner right after this program. Beginning at around 6:30 every Sunday, most of the people involved with the production of The Atheist Experience will head for Threadgill's restaurant at 301 West Riverside Drive in South Austin. It's a great opportunity to meet everybody involved with the show, and plus there's a special mystery event happening tonight. So if you've ever wanted to come down here, then come on down tonight.
Tonight would be the night.
Yes.
you got us all worked up, Russell.
I know.
It's better be good.
I should mention that I got some people worked up by posting on the blog that something unusual would be happening on this show. For all the people I suckered in, thanks for watching, but it's not happening. Maybe next month. Finally, the ACA also hosts an Atheist Happy Hour every Thursday beginning at around 7 p.m. at the Dog and Duck Pub located at the corner of 17th and Guadalupe. If you'd like to get in touch with us but you don't feel like calling in, you can always email us at tv@atheist-community.org. We, of course, get far more calls on this show than we can process, and priority is given to people who disagree with us. But if you're just getting in touch to praise our work, or if you want to start a long argument, you can often pull that off by emailing tv@atheist-community.org, but no promises. And sometimes you get featured on the blog, which
sometimes you do, yes.
Yeah, speaking of the blog, that is at atheistexperience.blogspot.com. And you can also check out the comprehensive counter-apologetics wiki at ironchariots.org. I do have one additional announcement, which
is... On the first Sunday of January is the 3rd, by the way.
Right.
Of January. Do we know who is lecturing us?
I don't know. I actually had it on the calendar, but I'm not going to hunt around for it.
Fair enough. Yeah.
Fred Edwards from the Coalition of Reason. And that sounds awesome.
What would we do without our prompts from the gallery?
After the nonprofits next week, Saturday, December 19th, you should check out the party that's being thrown in conjunction with the Center for Inquiry. It's a Saturnalia party, and it will take place at the First Unitarian Universalist Church. You can check out the ACA website for details. And I believe that's all, and in the traditional... nod to the people who are skipping the boring announcements on video. Pause.
Yeah.
Okay. How you doing, Martin?
I am great, actually. Yourself?
Yeah, I'm pretty good.
Yeah. No, it's been a good couple of, a pretty day today.
It's
so nice day for this.
Unseasonably warm here in Austin, where everybody who doesn't live here will not care.
Right. But we care because we live in all this.
That's right.
Doing fine.
Okay.
No complaint.
Let's see what we got here. We've already got full lines, and we're going to need them because we were planning to do this interesting thing.
Well, sure, guys, this is free phones for 90 minutes, so
okay.
Just...
So, tell you what, I've got these stories, which I will save for later in case it slows down, and, and I probably should have the call screening up. We got Joel in New York.
He's starting out. All right, so let's take him on.
Joel, are you there? Hi.
How you doing? I'm doing all right. Pretty good. I wish we had warm weather here, but we don't.
I bet.
But I was hoping to call in because I just finished recently reading a couple of Darwin's books. Mm-hmm. And if you're like me, you get irritated when you hear people claiming that Darwin was a racist and he hated black people and all that.
Mm. Right.
Yeah.
So I was hoping I could, if it's okay. We have a few instances that I remember from his books where he clearly did not display that sentiment, exactly the opposite.
All right, go for it.
Okay. In The Voyage of the Beagle, for example, he mentioned that in the coastline of South America, there was... I'm getting a reverberation thing. Is there anything I can do about that?
Oh, no, it's back. No, the control room can do something about it now that they know about
Thanks
it.
Thanks for letting us know, but just keep going best you can.
You're going to have to try to power through a little bit.
Yeah.
So, I understand. No problem. In South America, there was some cliffs, and a group of slaves at one point had ran away and climbed to the top to live. And when they were discovered, they apparently one of them threw herself off because she didn't want to go back to slavery, and Darwin actually wrote... something to the effect of, if a Roman woman had done that a long time ago, we would have called her, first she left freedom, but when the slaves do it, we just call them opposite, stubborn. He related how much he hated Brazil, because apparently there was a lot of slavery there, and just how much he wanted to leave the country. I can remember him staying with, he had to stay with people nearby on the journey, of course. And he said that there was a very nice black person who was running the house and wouldn't even eat with them, and that really bothered him because he liked the guy so much. The people that claim that I don't think they know what they're talking about.
Well,
honestly,
I would say that the racial views of Darwin would have been complicated because, after all, he lived in the 19th century when... Everybody was somewhat racist. I think it would be maybe whitewashing the issue to disregard quotes that creationists think bring up entirely. What do they say? He uses the word Negro a lot, and he talks about superior races. But One thing I think we can say is that Darwin was unusually progressive for his day. He lobbied a lot for the abolition of slavery. And, you know, if you go back and see some of the most admired people in the history of this country, I mean, Thomas Jefferson famously owned slaves.
Got them pregnant.
Did other stuff with them, yes.
I'm sorry. I just did the not nice version before you had a chance to cut me off.
Yeah.
I just do that.
But... Yeah. I mean, you know, it's difficult to jump to conclusions about what any one person believed in the light of today's standards, because there's been a lot of stuff going on between then and now. I mean, you know, there was the Civil War in America, there was the Civil Rights Movement in the 60s, and Darwin was British, so other stuff happened over there.
Yeah. I think it's sort of, it's overstating the case. A lot of people sort of glibly will say that, oh, well, it was 150 years ago and everybody was like that back then. No, I think everybody was most emphatically not.
Yes.
You know, to racist or, you know, in the way, I mean, certainly racial, views of racial equality, we've become more enlightened and they've evolved down through the years. But the simple fact that there were abolitionist movements and very involved ones going, you know, way back demonstrates that racism was not just this given among,
it's a bit of a stereotype that everyone back then thought.
Now, it's even abolitionists back then might not have been as tolerant on a personal level of, say, you know, racial equality
and
as we
what,
are.
What I like to point out, I always like to, not try to defend one particular person's views, but also in showing that the same view was pretty pervasive, I usually like to bring up a counterexample from the other side to demonstrate that it was across the board. Like, for instance, when I was in that email exchange with Chuck Colson a year ago, you remember?
Oh, yeah.
He brought up the fact that, he claimed that Christians were the people who were mostly behind the abolition of slavery. And I simply pointed out that Christians were some of the main people who were arguing for the continuation of slavery. And there's a famous sermon by a guy named Thornton Stringfellow who wrote all these biblical justifications why black people were naturally ought to remain in a slave state. Right. So
are we talking like the curse of Ham type stuff?
Yeah, something like that.
Along those lines.
A bunch of things. I mean, you know, slavery's all over the Bible.
Mm-hmm. Right, well, of course. Mm-hmm. You know, kill the Canaanites and take the women slaves and, you know, that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Right. I think what you'll find is that, particularly in the case of creationists, you know, they're just grasping at any straw they can to discredit evolutionary theory, and you hear a lot of these tortured arguments about how evolution is somehow responsible for racism and genocide and this, that, and the other thing, and, you know, as if it had never occurred before.
Yeah, because Darwin's personal opinions about these things aren't particularly relevant to the way the science is done today. Darwin was just the first guy who brought it up, and there have been a lot of scientists who discovered things who had pretty wacky views on different things.
But,
and even if he was racist, what difference does it make?
That's what I'm saying.
Well, it's to his theory. You know, to the to the accuracy of, you know, evolution by natural selection.
Certainly.
I think that I'm glad you brought this up because I think everybody should read Voyage of the Beagle. That's out of all of Darwin's books, that's the one that is the most accessible and I think entertaining to a modern reader, because
it's very interesting.
It's not even so much a science book. It's like one of the great classics of travel writing, and it's very fun to read. I think everybody should pick that one out.
Okay, well, thanks for calling, Joel.
Appreciate it.
Good to hear that you're reading the classics.
And, thank you.
All right.
Take care, and thanks for calling, man.
See you later.
Hey, you too. No problem. Thanks for taking my call.
No problem. See you later. Bye.
We have Ali in Yakima, Washington.
Oh.
And that is line three.
Ali.
Allie. Oh, so it's the fault of the call screener, maybe? Oh, I need to blame people.
No, you read A-L-I, and you thought it was Muhammad Ali, Ali. Okay. And, you're blushing.
Is it spelled correctly?
It's short for Allison. I just
Okay.
go by Allie.
Hey, Allie. How are you doing?
Hi, guys. I have a question. Do either of you have a background in theology at all?
Nope.
Well, in as much as having read some, but studied it on an academic level, no. Can't say I have.
Okay. Are you, were you guys raised in a religious household?
I was, he wasn't.
I was raised culturally Jewish, but my parents were basically both atheists. Basically.
Okay. Well, I'm a pagan, mm-hmm. and so I can really relate to how you guys do the atheist thing. Okay, I get that. And I'm a closet pagan to my family because they are so embedded in the church mm-hmm. and their way of life. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, as atheists, do you guys hide in the closet?
Well, we're on TV.
Yeah, I was just going to say.
So that's...
No, I mean, families and whatnot. Do you just pop out and say, hey, I'm an atheist? Or
well, this is more of a me question, because since you have an atheist family,
I have some things to add.
Right. But
yeah,
I was... Religion has become, in my family, the thing that we sort of agree not to talk about.
Yes.
It's not... It's a little awkward. We have lately been broaching it a bit. If it comes up, we'll actually have an exchange for a few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that we have to do that has only really added to my resentment in many ways of the Christian faith, because one of the things that it's done, my mother takes the whole thing very, very seriously,
mm-hmm.
you know, right down to the doctrine of hell.
Mm-hmm.
And so anytime the whole religion thing gets brought up, she becomes all upset and traumatized by the thought that her precious baby boy might spend eternity burning in hell. And, I mean, it genuinely upsets her. And so what Christianity has done in this instance is that it has filled her mind with this completely unnecessary fear and anxiety that does nothing but cause her emotional distress that she doesn't need, right?
Right.
And so I have a bit of added contempt for Christianity, just for that little detail. But it's mainly me sort of being considerate of them, in a sense, because they're family, so I give them a consideration
right.
that I don't necessarily give people who call this show
exactly.
or email us. But I think it's also because I'm aware that simply having been in... They're Episcopal. They're not really fundamentalist in that regard. I mean, they don't reject, for example, Darwinism. But they have very conservative attitudes about gays, for example. So they have some ideas of theirs have been informed by the church, but they're not what you think of when you think of like the Pat Robertson type of fundy.
Right.
But having said that, they are still, I think, even though they're in their 70s, they're just not equipped or haven't had the experience of defending their beliefs to someone who is, you know, a hard skeptic and unbeliever who is willing to ask tough questions and sort of hold their, you know, feet to the fire on it. So, and, you know, being that it's my mom and dad, we get along great. We have a, you know, wonderful little familial bond, and I see no reason to let religion come in and, you know, sort of foul that up. So,
right. I understand that, because I still go to church
mm-hmm.
with my family to put in FaceTime.
Right.
So I can be with them.
Yeah.
And today, I went to church with a friend of mine to have some FaceTime with her.
Okay.
And the pastor actually made a wisecrack about paganism, fasting for 700 days or so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you shouldn't be surprised that they're up there selling their product, and so they kind of have to slag the competition.
Yeah, and
you know,
so
any other business.
I of course am lucky that I don't have to come out to any members of my family. I mean, I always say, I'm a fourth generation atheist. My son is in the studio. He's fifth generation, at least so far.
Mm-hmm. He's going to show up in Krishna robes and a big topknot one day.
I happen to personally know that at least three people who are in the studio here today became atheists and then hid it from their parents for a while.
Yeah.
And in every single case, their parents discovered before they were ready to reveal it.
Mm-hmm.
And there was uncomfortable confrontation. And I personally know that I participated in one of those uncomfortable confrontations, because one of them is my girlfriend. And you know, parents are naturally suspicious of the guy who's dating their daughter. And so I also got to be the atheist who's dating their daughter after they found out she was an atheist. So I'm no stranger to the uncomfortableness, but I will say that once...
Girls just like bad boys, man.
Yeah.
That's just all there is to it.
Once you rip that scab off, though,
yeah.
I would I bet that all three people would agree with me that it was really a miserable experience to go through for a couple of months, and then it kind of settled down and just became sort of something normal. And either you get together with your family and argue about it occasionally, or there's just an unspoken agreement not to talk about it.
You're such a...
But I think you feel more comfortable with it afterwards.
Because you're so threatening, Russell. Yeah. I mean, just look at you.
I'm terrifying. Look at me.
Well, so... I didn't mean to shut the whole conversation down.
Okay. Anyway.
No, that's fine. That's fine. I'm watching you over the internet, so I can hear exactly what you're saying, and a friend of mine is sitting here watching it with me.
Well, okie dokie. Well, hello, friend.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, take care. Good luck with your family and friends and the rest of it. And,
All right. Thank you.
So long.
Okay, bye. Oh, well... I mean, the screener said that the question was, what is your opinion on paganism?
And maybe she decided to ask something else instead.
Yeah, all right.
So, you know, sometimes
that
can change.
That's right. I mean, the answer is, if there are supernatural beliefs involved, we don't agree. But as we think with Christians, as long as the beliefs aren't harming anybody, then, you know, live and let live, and we'll argue with it about it if you want.
And we're open to evidence.
Yeah.
So,
that's the nutshell answer to that.
Alrighty.
And next we have Dylan in Knoxville, Tennessee.
Extremely unusual.
Hello, Dylan?
Hi. Extremely unusual.
Dylan, are you on? Hello? You're on the air,
that
bud.
That was an interesting thing to walk into.
Okay.
Are you there?
I guess he's not.
Wait. Are you there?
Dylan?
No, this is not Doc, but I've come into an unusual...
Okay, this caller isn't working. Sorry.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, it's something bad.
Darn.
All right. So much for one.
I'd like to address that question anyway.
Oh, if that was...
The question on the screening thing was, can you prove that Jesus is not real? Mm-hmm. Martin, can you?
We're not trying to prove that Jesus is not real.
Yeah.
We're just responding to the claims and the arguments that we get from theists. In terms of if you want to ask, do we think there was a historical Jesus? My answer is, there probably was, to some degree, an actual historical figure who might have inspired the gospel character. But whatever scant and minuscule evidence we have, does any of it go to prove any of the supernatural claims about that character that are made in the gospels? No, we have nothing like that at all. So,
yeah,
may have been a real guy, but was he a divine being who, became a zombie and did all, no.
My answer that I've written about at length on the blog is there may have been a real guy named Jesus who was vaguely a jumping off point for the stories about Jesus who was written about in the Bible. I don't know whether there was or not. I think it's too far back in history for historians to really be sure, and there's not enough contemporary writings about it. But if there was a Jesus, I think he's as much the Jesus of the Bible as Larry David's friend Kramer was the real Kramer from Seinfeld. In other words, there was a real guy named Kramer, but he didn't do all the things that happened in Seinfeld. He was just sort of a quirky character whose ideas, whose behavior inspired the guy who did all that crazy stuff that was portrayed on the show.
Right.
So,
would not be unusual.
But can I prove that within, beyond unreasonable doubt?
No,
except to say that I don't think that any evidence indicates that somebody can curse a fig tree and make it die and and feed people with one loaf and fish.
And when you get right down to it, whether or not Jesus existed, I think, is not quite so relevant to us and to atheists in America as the fact that Christianity definitely does exist. And so we have to deal with that
true.
In our day-to-day lives. So, that's more relevant, I think.
Okay.
Line two.
Moving on to...
Local call.
Charles, right here in Austin.
Hello, Charles.
Hi, thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
Thanks
how you doing?
Thanks for calling.
I'm doing well, thank you. How are you?
We're fine.
Fine.
I'm great.
Glad to hear it. I would probably describe myself as a recovering atheist. I don't mean to attach a value judgment, like I'm better than you now or anything of that nature. But
okay.
I think if I were to give a positive definition of what I am, I think it's going to be pretty difficult. I think I'm probably leaning toward deism of some sort.
So you're saying you believe in a God, but not a God who's currently active in the world?
Essentially, I don't think you would probably, based on what I've seen from this show, accept my definition of a God as an appropriate definition for God. So I think that would probably be just a disagreement we'd have to observe. But I do think that I have some definite criticisms that are tangible, discussable, in very real terms about the show and what the show seems to purport, which is not what is often claimed as sort of the absence of position, a neutral position,
mm-hmm.
That is quickly dismissed by some very specific claims about material, the nature of material, and our knowledge about that material. And those claims seem to evince a complete lack of familiarity with the ongoing discussion that's done, whether it's theology, philosophy, or physics. And I can give you specific examples, but the first one, it's truly the sort of inane philistinism. And I don't mean to be mean, but I think that's the best way I can describe it. And
okay.
I think it's connected. I'm sorry, did you say something?
Go on.
Okay. And I think it's connected in a broader sense to new atheism, this sort of zeitgeisty thing, which is really just old materialism, a new philistinism, and probably most aptly called popular atheism, which is like asking Rush Limbaugh about economics. Okay.
Why don't we cut to the chase here?
Right.
And why don't you cure our philistinism by giving us hard evidence for this God that's not a God that you believe in?
I can't give you hard evidence.
Well, then what reason do we have to believe your claim, believe that it's accurate? I mean, why should we change our opinion?
I haven't established any position, and I told you I'm very confused. I'm persuadable. I think, unlike most people, I am persuadable.
Well, then what's your basis for saying that we're being Philistines when you admit that you can't back up what it is
you
claim to believe in?
The first thing I hear repeatedly on your show that comes to mind is Occam's razor used as a proof of something. Occam's razor.
No, I don't think Occam's razor is a proof of anything. It's a rule of thumb.
Well, yeah.
Okay, that's exactly right. But Matt Dillon, said specifically, I can point out the video to you, that he could disprove God by use of Occam's razor.
Based on what I know of Matt, I would be surprised if he ever said that I can disprove God. You might have heard a caller say that, but I know Matt's point of view really well.
I think he said he could disprove this person's version of God.
Well,
that as a possibility, and it doesn't eliminate possibilities.
Yeah, but Matt has also said, and I've been here on the show when he said it, that even, you know, when he says, and I agree with him, when I say, with total confidence that I don't believe a God exists, I'm still not making anything in the way of an absolute knowledge claim, right? So all we can do as atheists and skeptics is respond to the arguments that we get from people who claim to be believers.
More importantly, though, Matt's not here to defend himself right now, and both of us here in studio would not say that we can disprove God and would not say that Occam's razor can be used as any kind of proof. So is there anything else with our point of view that you would disagree
with? Well, I mean, to be fair, Matt is one of the representatives of this show.
Yeah, but he's not on today, so why? Well, you're talking
to us.
Accurate. So.
That's accurate. That's accurate. He's obviously not on the show.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, there's an overarching narrative that goes with the show, and that is a material interpretation of the universe. Let me see if you will agree with this. I saw another person on your show do this sort of inane explanation of the universe with physical objects and relating numbers being demonstrable by physical objects and saying that the two is demonstrable by putting two things anywhere. I mean,
well,
our numbers
can demonstrate it that way. Yeah,
you can demonstrate that. I mean, it was demonstrated. So are you saying that that's wrong?
I am saying that that is not a sufficient explanation of numbers, of cardinality of numbers, the uses of numbers. It's a completely insufficient conception of what numbers are.
So what's your explanation of numbers, God?
Yeah.
I would probably like Roger Penrose. Do you know who Roger Penrose is?
Yes, I've read The Emperor's New Mind.
Okay,
I disagree with a lot of stuff Penrose said, but I think he's a pretty smart guy.
Right. The book that would be pertinent to this is The Road to Reality, which doesn't deal with stuff out of his field. It's pure mathematics and physics,
mm-hmm.
and that's his field. You know, he was basically laying the foundation for Hawking. And he's a Platonist, or a Neoplatonist.
Mm-hmm.
And he thinks And I think that there is reason to believe that the world of mathematics is a non-material yet no less real entity. And to say that numbers are demonstrable isn't sufficient, okay, because what that necessarily implies is that numbers can be derived from the mind, okay, and that they are purely conceptual.
Okay. Well, they can be. I mean, you can conceive of numbers, right? I mean, you can.
Well, then you start. How is that wrong?
I mean, is it your claim that that's wrong? That we cannot conceive of numbers in the mind? That we cannot demonstrate things using numbers?
No, you cannot derive numbers from the mind.
Okay, clarify that.
What do you mean by derive?
Yeah.
Because from one point of view, you could not derive numbers from anything but your mind.
Are you familiar at all with the Platonist theory of forms?
Yes.
Okay. That would be the cause of our revelations, of mathematical revelations. Roger Penrose would say, when you're looking at a fractal represented visually, you're exploring a territory no less real than a mountainside.
Okay, can you move along to what this has to do with, is this going to get to God, or are you just complaining about us not sufficiently being in line with a Platonist point of view?
No, I think this may be a little too abstract
for the audience.
Okay, you're not sufficiently in line with any point of view. It's the methodology.
I'm in line with my point of view, so that's at least one.
I mean, what point of view should we be in line with, do you think? I mean, we're here basically as an atheist program. Our view as atheists, the reason we do this program is a response to religious programming and religious ideas. Our view is we don't believe that God exists.
What I just said. It's the methodology. It's not consistent with any workable methodology to figure out anything, no less atheism.
Atheism is a lack of belief in gods. Why does that need to be figured out? Some clown comes here and he says, oh, there's a big invisible magic man in the sky who grants me wishes, and we say, prove it, and he says, I can't, and we say, well, we don't believe in that. Beyond that, what do we need to prove here?
I'll tell you exactly what. First of all, a refutation of biblical interpretation of the Christian Bible is just as inane as a biblical interpretation of the Bible. Who are you arguing with? You're saying that you're refuting a biblical interpretation of the Christian Bible. That's your position.
A biblical interpretation of the Bible.
I'm not in the business of interpreting the Bible. My point of view about the Bible is there is no particular reason to take any of it seriously.
Yeah, we can only respond. I've said this already on the show tonight. We can only respond to the claims that we get from theists.
Which fallacy in particular is it?
Okay, it's a fallacy that you have this neutral position.
We don't claim to have a neutral position. We don't have a neutral position because we say quite openly we don't believe in any gods. How is that a neutral position? We're quite open about it. That's what the word atheist means.
I'm getting kind of tired of you here, Charles,
because I'm waiting for you to make a point.
Okay, and you're just rambling, and you guys aren't in line with this or that or the other.
But you're not giving us examples. You're not giving us any reason to believe. You're not giving us any reason to agree with you on things yet because you're not defending a position. You're just coming out with criticisms that are rambling and incoherent so far. A biblical interpretation of the Bible? I mean, come on. What is our point of view supposed to be?
To my ability to explain it. Now,
well, if you can't explain your ideas, how can we understand you?
The statement there is no God is not categorically different.
We don't believe in any gods. We did not say there is no God, and that is a categorical difference.
You are not a positive atheist.
I don't think you're understanding the word positive in context. I think what we mean when we say that we promote positive atheism is that we promote atheism in a positive way. We're the nice atheists, basically. We're the guys you want to hang out with.
The point is, at the very beginning of this call, okay, you know, you criticized us for not having whatever good methodology or reasoning and being inane or whatever. And so I said, okay, why should we believe in what it is that you claim to believe? Please defend your beliefs. You admitted you couldn't, so why are we still talking? Unless you can, sort of...
That's not what I said.
We can probably play back the recording and show it. So, again, give us some reason why your point of view is right. You think we're wrong, so obviously you think that you have a point of view that is more accurate in terms of understanding the world and the universe than ours is. Fine. Please defend that. Present your evidence for what it is that you believe and let us evaluate it.
I think the notion of a cause existing outside of a knowable, observable universe is cognitively useful.
It might be cognitively useful.
It's cognitively useful, but is it true?
Is it accurate? I mean, the notion of that I have a pet unicorn who gives me rides every day might be cognitively useful, but what does it demonstrate about reality?
And see, that's exactly what I'm talking about. That's what you have just done.
What, is pointed out how stupid your argument is?
No, see, that it's not a stupid argument, because it's...
So what if something is cognitively useful?
...about epistemology, my ability to know. You're just trying to stick a unicorn in my mouth that made me look silly, but, you know, I can't...
That would look pretty silly.
That would look... Your ability to know something has nothing to do with whether or not a certain concept is cognitively useful. It has to do with, can you demonstrate that it's real and has application?
Okay, demonstrate that 4 is real.
1, 2, 3, 4, I can,
No, how is it real? In what capacity is it real? What is the nature of its existence?
4 is a word that describes a concept, basically.
So you're saying then that God is just an abstract
representation
of something?
And now we're right back where I started, and you just griped at me saying that this had nothing to do with anything, and we're now very in the midst of the argument I was just presenting, because this is the same consistent viewpoint that's presented on this show. And it is a materialist viewpoint. You're going to tell me that numbers are only important, are only in any way imaginable as conceptual tools. They have no use or existence outside of our conception. They are derived and bound within the mind.
Well, whose conception should be useful to us? You know, aliens from an alternate dimension? I mean, our conceptions of things do help us understand certain things, but mostly when we're looking at truth claims, and this is what religion hits us with, right? Religious people call us up and they make claims that in their mind are truth claims. They claim to know that there is some sort of divine being, that he does X, that he wants X from us in terms of worship and belief.
Right.
And we respond to that by asking for the evidence. And if we don't get it in such a way that we think it's a satisfying answer, compelling evidence, we'll tell them, well, we don't really see any reason to believe you. So why is that wrong for us to take that attitude, that approach?
That approach, because that's not the approach you're taking. What you are taking is necessarily dependent upon the statement you just made. Okay.
Should I make points of view that are? Should I embrace views that aren't dependent upon statements that I make and ideas that I actually have?
You're making. It's a sophistic claim to say, oh, I'm from this neutral position. I don't believe this. You have to give me
evidence.
We
don't say
so
we're
this.
From a neutral position. You are trying to tell us
not,
we say stuff
say,
that we don't say. Listen, let me cut to the end of your argument. Does God exist?
I think so.
Okay. Do you have a reason for that, or do you just like believing in it because it's a useful concept?
No. I think the distinction I would have to make is it's from C.S. Lewis, and he said he believes in God like he believes in the rising sun.
I can see the rising sun, dude, so I think that you're arguing for a different God, because if it was anything like the rising sun, you wouldn't have to go off on all these tangents about the number 4 and stuff.
No.
If you want to defend God as a concept that's in your mind, or if you want to defend God as something that's just the way the universe works, then that's fine. You can believe that stuff. What?
Do you know what figurative language is?
Yeah, is God figurative language?
No, but
why ask that then?
If it's a thing that exists,
and you misinterpret it as literal, that's ridiculous. You won't even let me finish what I was saying, and you say, "Oh, the rising sun, I can see." That's a
comparison that
you
made.
The comparison to the rising sun.
That's how we interpret the world, is by making figuration, synthesis. I mean, that it's not idiotic. The quote, it's actually the means by which I was going to tell you why I think God might be necessary. And that is because C.S. Lewis, he thought of God like the rising sun. Not only that he saw it rise, but by it he saw everything else.
So, in other words, he interpreted the rising sun to be God.
Hold on. The notion of causality, which is what I presented as my belief, as my definition of God, is not necessarily central to the existence of the universe, but it may be central to my understanding of it.
Mm-hmm.
And
so
that is why I require God to talk to you about it, because I make the presumption when I talk to anyone that what I'm saying is intelligible. And I think intelligibility may require causality.
Well,
so
you might want
to
reexamine
that
assumption in the future.
Ignore causality, maybe irrational.
So essentially, God is simply your word for causality?
Well, it's a very specific cause, yes.
Okay. Well, it seems to me like you've just come up with another word for causality.
Well,
and, I mean, if that's cognitively useful, fine, but...
Yeah. You agree there's something outside of our universe that caused it? We're in agreement?
I don't see any reason to think that there is anything outside of our universe.
Unless we're talking about a metaverse of some sort.
But that's all speculative. Again, we have no more hard evidence for a megaverse than we have for heaven. So,
megaverse is equivalent to theism.
But my point of view is that beyond talking about it in speculative terms as an idea that might be interesting, like alternate dimensions or faster than light travel, it's really not useful for any sort of.
What if it has a mathematical basis? That's the problem we're running into.
A mathematical
is that you have an impoverished view of reality that is based on your interpretation of material. It has no other balance through which to view it. That's the problem. That's my criticism. And you say, no, that's not valid, but then you continue to demonstrate it over and over again.
Well,
and I don't mean to be mean, but you're not aware of it. These are not issues I'm bringing up. These are issues that are current modern-day issues in philosophy, in physics, in every realm of human inquiry. And you can't dismiss them with some slipshod, well, that's silly. I'm from a neutral position. You have to convince me.
There you go, straw manning again, man.
Okay.
I mean, you're just...
Actually,
you
know. We can dismiss them as silly, especially when you keep saying things over and over again that we've already disagreed with.
Yeah, and you keep straw manning us. look, if you can use mathematics to prove a physical location outside the universe and then find some way that we can actually get hard evidence of that, fine. When it comes to philosophy, well, you know, as far as I'm concerned, philosophers can do what they do until the cows come home, but...
Well,
I don't see any reason why...
Not to mention the fact that the dirty little secret of philosophy is that the great majority of them, like a lot of scientists,
are
atheists.
But yeah, I mean, why you at no point explained why it was wrong to prefer evidence before latching yourself to a knowledge claim. I mean, okay, abstract concepts, mathematical concepts, it's fine, it's speculative. You know, maybe it shouldn't necessarily always be dismissed, but you should always be aware that when you're talking about that sort of thing, you know, you should say, all right, we're not reaching definite conclusions here. This is speculative, and it's maybe worthy of further study. That's fine. But to say, oh, well, I use all kinds of complicated mathematics, and therefore I have some higher understanding of reality than you. Yeah, well, you know, if you can't, and then you can't explain it coherently, it's not our fault, so.
Okay.
All right. I got a little tiresome.
We started out by him saying that we wouldn't accept his definition of a god, and then went on to not define any god and ramble about.
Well, I mean, he kept complaining and protesting that we were wrong and
let's
and
not
shallow
talk about
in name,
him
but
too much while he's gone though.
Well, but email us and again explain why we're wrong here. I mean,
work your thoughts more thoroughly out on paper.
I mean, saying that we're wrong and then admitting that you can't really prove.
Okay. Brady in San Francisco, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Thanks for waiting so patiently. That certainly did fill some time.
Yes, it did. Hey, I have a question about the so-called war on Christmas.
Yes?
I'm an atheist, so I'm not being like, oh, you stinking non-believers taking away my...
Do you need marching
Jesus.
Orders?
No. Last week, my school newspaper came out with a new edition, and on the back, it's got all the fun stuff on it, like jokes and comics and whatever, and on one of them, it's the top 10 worst Christmas gifts to receive.
Mm-hmm.
And, Russell, I want your opinion on this, since you were raised in a Jewish household. One of the things, I think it was number 4, was a menorah. That's one of the worst gifts to get.
Well, I mean, if it's a Christmas present, then
I know that's
I don't know. It's not that
saying,
funny. It's not that offensive either. It's just kind of lame.
It might be fun to just make your school nervous by bringing that little thing to the attention of the ADL, and just seeing where that goes.
I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I just thought it was strange. I mean, I wasn't offended by it. I thought some people could potentially be offended, but...
Well, actually, I do have something to say about that. Mm-hmm. There is no war on Christmas. What there is a war on the celebration of all other religions.
Right.
That is very true.
There is nobody going around trying to tell people that they should not celebrate Christmas in their own way, that they should not set up their own decorations, that they should not tell each other Merry Christmas. What there are is a whole bunch of loons going around getting freaked out and furious because some people aren't saying Merry Christmas enough. Mm-hmm. So some people just flipping out going, oh my gosh, he said happy holidays. He's oppressing me. Mm. I think that...
come and see the violence and
I mean, you know, as a not very observant Jew, but uh-huh. somebody who pays some attention to Hanukkah, it's become harder and harder to actually find things like menorahs and candles and you know, the other trappings of Hanukkah, dreidels. At stores over the years that I've occasionally attempted to do that. Mm-hmm. And so what I think is that this trumped up war on Christmas is nothing more than Christians declaring war on anything that isn't Christmas.
And so, it gives them that sort of social and, communal and reinforcement think, thing. Of yeah. thinking that, oh,
and
we're
I
so
think
oppressed.
That thing in your newspaper fits right in with that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you could go like Roy Zimmerman and celebrate Christmas, Hanukkah, Ramadan, Kwanzaa.
Hey, did you practice that? That was great.
That's good, yeah.
I had to think about it a few seconds ahead of time, but yeah.
Well, that's...
And, yeah, one last quick little question to wrap this up. Do you have the spoon there? Is it still a spoon?
No, the spoon's Matt's thing. I don't have
yeah,
it.
Matt must have the spoon, so there, it's in a quantum state.
Unfortunately, as you can see, there is no spoon.
Yes. We have realized the truth that there is no spoon. Mm-hmm.
Yep. There's but a mug.
And it is
all
not
right.
the
well,
mug.
Thank you guys. Thanks for taking my call.
All right. Thank you, Brady.
Thank you.
Have fun.
All right. Thanks for calling. for people who don't watch regularly, Matt's got a spoon that he's been telling believers for years to pray that it will turn into a fork.
Hmm.
And it hasn't yet, as far as I know. Although I haven't seen the spoon, so what is Matt hiding?
Oh. See, that's just you and your inane materialism, wanting evidence for things.
Oh, yeah, that is pretty inane. Chris in Jacksonville, Florida. Are you there?
Chris? Did we lose Chris in Jacksonville?
Hello?
Chris!
Hello.
Hello.
Hi there.
Hi. What's you're up? On. You're on. What's your question?
My question is, surely I love your show, and I love the arguments you have with the fervent theist that just love to have arguments with you that go nowhere.
No, that one didn't really. Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
So, if you're still listening to the stream, make sure that you turn it down or close the browser or something.
Mm-hmm. It's close.
Okay.
I was trying to watch
this. Anyway, Chris, what's on your mind?
My question was about less the mainstream Christian and Islamic and mainstream religions, but cult fringes built upon me. I recently had a girlfriend who, thankfully, due to my rationality denying, was able to fight off her family attempt to indoctrinate me.
Okay. Congratulations.
What have you to say to the fringe who try to put...
Chris, I'm going to have to ask you to talk a little faster if you can, or...
I'm getting some feedback as well.
Oh, there's still that problem in the studio.
Okay, and you're breaking up on our end, too. You sort of sometimes you sound a little... Are you on a cell phone, by any chance?
Yes.
Okay, that can maybe happen. Maybe you need to go where there's a better signal or something.
Okay. Let me put you on hold, and we'll try to get back to you in a couple minutes and see if that problem has cleared up any.
Yeah. Is that all right?
My question is really quick, so
okay.
Real quick.
Go ahead.
These French.
No, I'm sorry. Your cell phone is breaking too much.
We didn't hear. We can't hear any of that.
Yeah, I'm putting you on hold. I'll try again in a couple of minutes.
Sorry, Chris. That's just not happening.
If we can't get to you, then we see what might be your question on the call screen box, and
right.
we'll try to say a few words.
Or unless he's someone who's thought up a different question.
I don't know.
If we're not able to get back to you, send us an email at tv@atheist-community.org, and maybe we can answer your question that way. Sorry.
Okay. By a weird coincidence, we have another Charles in Austin.
Hello.
Are you there?
Hello.
Hi, hello, you're on.
Hello.
Awesome. my question is more to the line of what your show is about, the atheist mm-hmm. experience, and that's kind of what I'm interested in. I'm a Christian, but it bothers me when I hear other so-called Christians call your show. I think a lot of times they're really duping themselves into thinking that they're going to somehow convert you over the telephone, and I think it's ridiculous. I think that a lot of times the individuals end up making fools out of themselves, because the old argument, and like I heard when you were talking with the other Charles from Austin, you were mentioning that, you know, he was saying something about C.S. Lewis and seeing the sun rise up in the sky. Mm-hmm. You made a very cogent point as to, well, I can look at the sun and there it is. You know, I see it with my eyes.
Yes,
as opposed
but not for
to
very long, or I'll
God,
myself.
Who kind of denies me that, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
My question is this, and it speaks completely toward the atheist experience. I'm curious as to what atheists believe in as maybe as a generality, if there is any generality, or if the atheist experience as far as belief goes is too random to generalize. But I'm curious, does an atheist or an atheist in general see anything do they view anything as larger than them, something that they can look up to, maybe themselves as an evolved being sometime down the line in the future, or do they look toward, say, another individual, a poet, or a... I'm curious, is there any general reality, a lot of Hindus believe in this kind of amorphous essence that we join up with after mm-hmm. we die? And I'm curious about that from the atheist point of view.
Okay.
Do you folks view anything as larger than yourselves, something that you look to for strength, for inspiration, or... do you simply view yourselves in an evolved form as your ultimate?
Yeah, we get it.
That's difficult to answer in a number of ways. I mean, I could go with a literal answer like, well, an elephant's bigger than me, or Arnold mm-hmm. Schwarzenegger is bigger than me.
Well, I'm really thinking greater in a celestial type of fashion.
Right. Well, I mean, you asked, like, if I look up to any particular person.
Sure.
And I mean, you know, personally, I have a number of heroes. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, people whose opinions I respect. But, I mean, they're my heroes not as the result of the idea that they are intrinsically better than me, but simply because I've listened to them or seen what they've done, and they make sense and have done something admirable. It's particularly hard to answer this for all atheists, because not only do we not speak for all atheists, but we can't speak for all atheists, because atheism as such isn't really a point of view. It's more of a rejection of one particular claim, which is lots of people believe in a God, we don't. That's pretty much all there is to being an atheist. Now, there are a lot of atheists who believe in other things besides gods, and There are a lot of people who believe dramatically different things from what we would believe. I would say that on this show, we try to present a fairly consistent point of view, which mm-hmm. is basically that science is a legitimate way of investigating the world, that it's good and reasonable to be skeptical of unusual claims until evidence is provided. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, in that sense, I wouldn't say that there's a particular thing that we all look up to, although we all have individual heroes. I don't worship myself. In fact, I'm not even sure that I particularly agree with the idea that anything should be worshipped. I think things that are admirable should be admired, mm-hmm. and I think that there shouldn't be any kind of blind, unconditional trust in anything because mm-hmm. you should be open to changing your mind at any point.
Yeah. I would say the difference between the perhaps the atheist and the theist outlook on this would be that atheists reject the idea of sacred cows, you know what I mean? We really do think that everything ought to be questioned. And whereas we might have individuals or ideas or certain things that we admire and respect and consider to be, you know, rather authoritative and helpful, we do not consider those to be inviolable in any way. Now, in terms of thinking, do I think of anything larger than myself? Well, naturally, I do. And one of those things would be the great human race that I'm part of, right? This community of billions of other people.
I was looking for a quote from Bertrand Russell that uh-huh. I really liked. It's from an essay called Freedom and the Colleges, and I think it kind of sums it up, where he says, the fundamental difference between the liberal and illiberal outlook is that the former regards all questions as open to discussion and all opinions as open to a greater or lesser measure of doubt, while the latter holds in advance that certain opinions are absolutely unquestionable right. and that no argument against them must be allowed to be heard. So we're in the first camp, basically.
I see. So you're saying, as atheists, you keep open minds.
Sure.
Well, you could say that.
Well, atheism being, I guess, a subcategory of skepticism in general, yes, as skeptics. Something like that.
I would say that I am both an atheist and a skeptic, and you are too.
Right. So.
That's extremely curious. I once had a priest tell me that it's easier to convert a non-believer than it is to rightly point out what's right and what's wrong to a wrong believer, that the wrong believers, they plant themselves so deeply in their belief systems that you almost can't talk to them.
I mean, there are all kinds of points of view that are not Christianity, that are probably, you know, diametrically opposed to Christianity, that we also don't agree with. I mean, you mm-hmm. know, there are people who are... take Muslims, for example. Mm-hmm. We, in the same way that we think Christians deserve respect as human beings, we would also extend that respect to Muslims. But Muslims, you know, have very different ideas about God than Christians, and we don't agree with either of them.
Right.
Right.
And I imagine that it might be harder to convince a Muslim, although mm-hmm. I think that someone who is sort of rigorous about demanding evidence mm-hmm. usually comes away not finding any. Right. So it depends on the person.
And I think you've pointed out also a reason why, you know, an evidence-based sort of rational outlook on the world is probably, in our opinions anyway, probably better than one that relies upon beliefs and faith, because the people whom you are, for example, referring to as wrong believers, they think you're the wrong believer. And, you know, they think, and they would say the same thing about, you know, I tried to talk to that guy and talk to him, and he just wouldn't change his mind, right? And so this is why I think perhaps, knowledge is, or at least being willing to admit that, you know, in the absence of knowledge, not filling in gaps in knowledge with beliefs and faith, is probably, in the end, intellectually a more defensible way to go about your business than saying, well, I just believe this because it makes me feel good. And since you don't seem to be fundamentalist in your beliefs, but it takes, when you get to the fundamentalists who take that sort of rigid, inflexible attitude about their beliefs, like you were talking about, then that gets really, I think, problematic.
That kind of goes to a larger issue within Christianity, fundamentalism as opposed to orthodoxy. Mm-hmm. I'm Greek Orthodox.
Okay.
I have a very open mind, and I'm willing to talk nicely and listen to other people's points of view and then back off.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know been very nice.
I personally don't think anything is served by a forceful approach, especially when you're dealing with something that claims tolerance and compassion first and foremost.
Right.
So I definitely have a lot of disagreements with a lot of, I guess, American Christianity
right.
as a whole.
Right.
But I guess what I'm hearing you say, and back to the name of your show, The Atheist Experience, mm-hmm. is that, number one, you guys speak from your own personal experience and not for all other atheists.
That's true. Yeah. A lot of people obviously identify with us because we get a lot of email mm-hmm. thanking us, but we also get tons of email who are angry because they're atheists and we said something that they didn't like.
Mm-hmm.
Jen, who's here in the studio, often talks about anti-vaccination people mm-hmm. as being sort of anti-science and foolish, and there are plenty of atheists who have that point of view and don't like to hear that.
Yeah, we get people in the atheists who are completely sold on the whole 9/11 conspiracy
right. but
ideas.
But
that
actually
kind of
adds to my point
yeah,
because
yeah, really.
Some people could accuse us of being cult leaders or something, but the fact yeah. is there are a lot of people who would supposedly be on our side who think we're full of it, and mm-hmm. we're okay with that.
Yeah, yeah. And what you said before about not taking a forceful position on things, I don't think there's anything wrong at all with having convictions, right?
Sure.
And being willing to defend them forcefully. But you should still retain an open mind and a willingness to hear the other guy's side and argue for it.
Well, like you said earlier, respect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. I really do think it's about mutual respect. I mean, let's face it. Nobody is ever going to listen to your argument if the best you can do is just argue with them. You know?
Or just when you're resorting to fallacies and getting angry and, just...
Sure, yeah. And I think this is my last question. I'll leave you guys with this.
Okay.
It sounds like you were saying some of the atheists get angry because you don't support their beliefs also. Do you guys ever deal with a lot of cognitive dissonance in your movement, or it sounds like you yourselves live with open minds. I'm curious if science were to, through this, like this black hole creator, this atom smasher that they were building, everybody was mm-hmm. afraid they were going to build a black hole that was going to suck up the earth, and if at some point scientists were able to dig deep enough or go far enough to actually prove or disprove God, and I would go with the latter, if they were actually able to prove God, you guys would take that into consideration and wouldn't suffer from the same cognitive dissonance that you expressed other people suffering from earlier, right?
Yeah, just because we're atheists doesn't mean that we're permanent atheists.
Yeah,
I think we always say we're open to evidence. We don't mm-hmm. expect any, we've been looking for it for a while and haven't seen it come in, but
right.
If some really good knockdown argument was made for the existence of God, I think it would be possible that some people would change their minds.
Right, well, for example, one thing I usually say to people who ask me about ideas like the afterlife, right? Life after death. I tell them I'm all for it, right? Great idea. But again, I would rather, if there is none or if there is no good evidence for one, I think that it is perhaps both emotionally and intellectually healthy to just accept the reality in which we live, accept that we are here but for a very short time, and so we have to make all of it count, and this is all we get, rather than just adopting a belief system that is really nothing more than sort of a shield over, you know, my fear of my mortality. And
wow.
So that's, you know, we're just not big on putting our ignorance on an altar and calling it faith, which a lot of religious people seem to do.
Very cool. I think I'd like to say I probably, as an Orthodox Christian, have a little bit more in common with you folks than I do with a lot of Protestants and Roman Catholics.
Right. Except for the God thing. But
we're,
you know,
well,
speaking,
we're glad of that, because
yeah,
I always say that as atheists, we're not here to make enemies of people. We would like to have as many people close to our sides, even if they disagree about the philosophical background.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think what's cool, and I think the other people listening can take heart from, is that you keep open mind. And I think that's the best for everybody.
Thank
Back
you.
At you.
You guys have a great one. Bye.
Thanks for your call,
you
Charles.
Too. Bye-bye.
Okay.
I would like to take James in Canton, Ohio.
Yes, I think they have him on the list for him.
James.
Hello.
Hi,
how are you guys doing?
Fine.
We're great.
I just want to talk about something since Christmas is coming up.
Hmm.
My question goes to both you guys, the hosts, and to the literal Bible believers that are listening. Let's see, where do I start? Basically, in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 10, there's a passage that talks about how you're not supposed to do the customs of the worthless people in other nations. And one of those customs it lists is cutting down a tree and putting it up in your home and decorating it. And when I was discussing this with my family, it was hard enough to convince them that there were 600 commandments instead of 10. I tried to point this part out to them. Uh-huh. And the reasoning that I got from them was from outside the Bible. And they started to feel threatened about their, American identity. And they said, well, it's an attack on Christmas. It's an attack on everything American, and I was pointing this right out to them from the Bible, and I wasn't really getting a straight answer.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess my question is why do you think people who claim the Bible is literal line by line, why do they reason from outside of the Bible when it's presented to them right there in front of them? It just seems like you never get a straight, concrete answer.
Well,
and
I mean,
if you're against gay marriage, because mm-hmm. the Bible says so, and because the Bible says it's true, then why do you put a Christmas tree up in your home?
I would suggest that, not to burst in, but I would suggest that a lot of the people who call themselves biblical literalists are the ones less likely to have actually read the Bible through word for word, and because you can always point to some little discrepancy like that, right? And you, when you immediately ask them about such issues as, okay, well, if you're against abortion, for example, for biblical reasons, show me where it's mentioned in there, because it isn't. It's always funny how the Bible is literally true except when it's not. You know, like
right.
how it's how God is all-powerful except when he's not, right? Point out a little area where their beliefs are not entirely consistent, and then they scramble to place some CYA. And it just sort of reveals that they're just kind of going on gut instinct here and not a literal interpretation. Because, of course, if they say that the Bible is literally true, then you would have to point out to them that the very first time as a child you ever disobeyed them, they were under orders to kill you. Right?
Mm.
I mean, just drag you out in the street and pelt you to death with stones.
I've got a handy message
yeah.
from the control room who quoted the particular verse you mentioned of Jeremiah 10:3. For the customs of the people are worthless. They cut a tree out of the forest, and a craftsman shapes it with his chisel.
Oh, well, there you go. See, because if I were a Christian, I would say, but my Christmas tree is plastic, so it doesn't count,
oh,
right?
Yeah.
See, and
or,
I get around it that way.
I don't know. In talking to Christians, there are all kinds of ways you can weasel out of the Bible. I mean,
mm-hmm.
you can say, even if you say that the Bible has to be literal word for word, they're also saying, like, oh, yeah, but that part of the Bible is Jesus using some symbolism.
Mm-hmm.
And so he literally said that. Yeah.
It's literal except then where it's symbolic.
Yeah.
Or metaphorical.
So, I mean, or you can have situations where there's an obvious apparent contradiction in the Bible, and, you know, there's no end of ways to get out of that. I mean, you know, it could say, one verse could say, Jesus had a dog and no cat, and another verse could say Jesus had a cat and no dog, and they would say, like, oh, well, these came after each other, or or, you know, the Greek word is actually translated so that it's another meaning of dog or something like
right.
that. I mean, there are so many different oddities of the Bible and the way people interpret it that I usually just don't bother, because in the end, I don't care what the Bible says.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And I think that getting sidetracked into issues like, oh, you want to, you know, you want to follow the Bible, but the Bible says this and you don't follow it, mm-hmm. is really kind of going off on a tangent from the more important fact, who cares what the Bible says?
Yeah, right. Well, Christians have a $20 word for the whole biblical interpretation thing, which is hermeneutics, which is Christianese for insist that the Bible is literally true until somebody points out something in it that is inconsistent or reprehensible morally or what have you, at which point you say something like, well, you're not interpreting the Bible properly. And that's kind of how it works.
I see.
So, and you sound like a guy who might be interested in checking out the Iron Chariot's wiki, if you haven't looked at it yet. That's the counter-apologetics.
I've Facebook, but I've never checked it out, but
yeah.
I'll do that.
Because we just noticed that your original question, at least as it's listed here, is what advice do you have for debating fundamentalist Christians? And that's sort of a good shop for some basic counter-apologetics arguments.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks for calling.
Bye.
All right, I guess I'll go to John in Fort Lauderdale.
He's been waiting a while.
Okay, John?
Hi, this is Deron, actually, in Fort Lauderdale.
Oh, Ron.
Oh, okay. They've misspelled you. How you doing?
I'm fine. Wanted to note that I'm a black atheist in Fort Lauderdale, a former Christian. I just say that because they seem to get so few callers of that of this persuasion. But my question was, well, actually a comment was, that I find that a lot of at least black Christians now are, in my area, are popping up little small put-together ministries and where they're gathering their money or raising their money and getting little spaces in small strip malls to set up a church and a ministry to supposedly reach and spread the gospel, the good word of God to people. And it seems like they can't step back and say that maybe I am myself just being, you know, a little egotistic, and if there are already established ministries in Christianity in my local area, maybe I can raise money for them or help them, because they're already spreading the word. But it seems like everyone wants to have their own piece of the cake to spread the word, because they feel like maybe they're going to be the next TD Jakes or something.
Well, it's the Web 2.0 version of Christianity. It's the ministry that everyone can edit.
Yeah.
I guess that's kind of where technology is sort of leading people these days, in that, there's no need to actually have everybody on the same page. You can just... you can just find your own little niche group and get your own crowd. Of course, that fragments people further and further. But then again, I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah, I mean, when you get right down to it, Ron, all you're really talking about is this is just sort of American free enterprise doing its thing, right? And so it's, they could probably go ahead and join established churches if they wanted to, but they want their own. It's like somebody decides to open his own pizza place instead of just going to Pizza Hut every day. You know, he thinks he can do it better. So that really I don't see as being much of a concern for us as atheists, except that it all does, you know, bring back the age-old question of, if this is all one truth, right, from the Bible, why are there 60 billion different denominations and schisms and sects and subsects and what have you? You'd think God would at least come down and clarify everything.
I think I actually looked up the real number, and it's like 38,000 now.
Okay, so I was a little high. But
yeah.
You know, all
it's still a big number, though.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, long and short of it is, you know, you don't have to go to any of those churches if you don't want to. So let them do their thing. It's a free country. Big deal.
Oh, yeah, I fully understand that. One last little topic that I had was that being down here, well, I'm in Fort Lauderdale area, I find a lot of young black Christians that if I happen to talk to them or they talk to me, however it starts, and they find out that I'm atheist, I can't really get past any of them on the Pascal's wager. I mean, I can tear it down any way I want to, but it seems like they pop it up and they mention it, but they don't really have never heard of Pascal, mm-hmm. even though they're using it to try to get me back on the side. And
right.
it seems like at least in the black community that I find that they're so lacking critical thinking that they haven't even gotten beyond the part of their own belief that they're actually believing, partly because they feel like they have to choose something, because if they die, then at least they, you know, maybe mm-hmm. God is, maybe Jesus is real, and they don't want to go to hell, so they have to hold on to something, and mm-hmm. it seems like they're really not going beyond that, you know, they've been taught it, and they're not beyond the point of even
right.
thinking
well,
about maybe that's not true at all.
You know, you don't have to know Pascal to mm-hmm. think that Pascal's wager is convincing. Just like earlier in the show, we said that Darwin's personal disposition is of no relevance to the theory of evolution. But what I like to say to mess with people who believe in Pascal's wager is, why aren't you a Muslim? You know, if it turns out that Muslims are right, then God is going to be way more mad at those people who were worshiping Jesus as a false idol than us who just, you know, stayed skeptical. So if Islam is real, then I'd put a lot more money on our chances than theirs.
Yeah. Pascal's wager basically gives you, if you genuinely think it's a legitimate way to go about your business, no reason whatsoever not to just go ahead and join every single religion on the face of the earth just to cover your bases.
Right.
Right?
Plus, I should mention, I am God. And, you know, mm-hmm. you can subscribe to my heaven guarantee for a mere $50 a month.
I don't believe you, Russell.
It's a bargain. Oh.
I think God's beard is whiter.
For the public access TV censors, mm-hmm. that was not a real appeal for money. That was a joke.
Parody.
But as I was saying, you know, you can subscribe for $50 a month, and I'll make sure that you have a spot in heaven. And really, $50 a month is a bargain to make sure that you avoid an eternity of suffering.
Can you take the chance?
Right.
Right. I think what you're talking about, though, quickly, there, Ron, I don't know. I mean, you have a perspective into the African-American community, but I don't know that. I think what you're seeing reflected is religion in general, Christianity in general. And you'll get the same thing in most, particularly fundamentalist churches, where it is, you know, they just, it's all a big emotional appeal when you get right down to it. And they play upon, you know, basic insecurities people have. And I think that's one thing that religion has been very successful at doing. Not successful in terms of giving you maybe the right answers, but certainly making sure the emotional hot buttons are all pushed when it comes to managing fundamental insecurities about life and death and, you know, what it's all about. Religion has been very effective about that. And when you realize that people are very emotional creatures, in addition to rational ones, and in many cases more emotional than rational, it's a pretty effective sales tool. It's been mentioned many times that there seems to be a disproportionately low representation in the atheist community of African Americans and other races, other non-white races. And do you know other African American atheists yourself, or are you the only guy you know? Have other friends, or are you?
I would say that I have been atheist for about 5 years or 4 years, and I have met only one in person, only one agnostic. Mm-hmm. And that's mm-hmm. as far as it has gone. Yeah. I joined a Facebook thing,
right.
Black Atheist Alliance, I believe it's called, and that's about it. And that's maybe has like 120 members, and mm-hmm. it's pretty scarce out here, at least when you bump into people. Maybe you'll see mm-hmm. them at Starbucks and you don't know, but as far as people that you get in conversations mm-hmm. with, people that talk to you here are Jehovah's Witnesses, and they're trying to, you know, convert you, you know.
Yeah. Maybe it's just that the church has been really, really effective in its outreach to the African-American community. So.
maybe.
Otherwise, but
we've had this conversation on the show for a couple of weeks. I think if you go back and listen to the last show in the archives that Jen and I were on together, there's a long run of calls from black atheists talking about it, about that issue. And I think the following week there were more of those.
Right, yeah.
But anyway, yeah, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. But thanks for calling and giving us your point of view, and just keep challenging them to think is all I can say.
All right, I'll do that. I love the show. I've been listening for about 3 years, maybe. I've heard all the shows.
Wow. So. Well, thank you.
Thank you for calling.
All right. Take care.
Bye.
All righty, though.
Okay. This is, we got 10 minutes left, 8 minutes left. It's a fun show.
This has been an excellent one. Thanks, everyone who's
okay,
called.
And if you, if you have been enjoying this and would like to get together and meet with us, this is a great day to come to Threadgills at 301, oh, help me, control room.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, anyway, the downtown Threadgills on West Riverside Drive. There you go.
You almost had it.
301 mm. West Riverside Drive, and I knew the Riverside part.
That's right.
6:30 p.m., we'll all be there, and it's going to be a lot of fun today.
There'll be a big surprise.
So, let's see who we got.
Which is you paying, that's it, right? That's the big surprise.
That is not it. Trust me.
I'm just drawing a blank.
Jason in Tampa, Florida. Hello?
Yes, hi. Can you hear me?
Hi. Yes, we can. Hi.
I have a quick question about strong atheism versus weak atheism.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to kind of better define my position. And my question is, for those of you who host the show, what position do you guys take? And do you think that strong atheism is actually justifiable?
Okay. I think that strong atheism, and to define the terms, a strong atheist is one who basically claims with certainty that there is no God, versus a weak atheist who simply says that it's basically open to doubt. Would that be a fair way to put it?
Yeah, I guess so. You could say a strong atheist says there is no God, and a weak atheist says, I don't believe in God.
Yeah, basically.
Right.
Richard Dawkins would be a weak atheist. I mean, you know, people think of him as this sort of, I might say, fire and brimstone kind of atheist, the spearhead of the terrifying new atheist movement. And yet Richard Dawkins in The God Delusion has a passage where he enumerates the possible positions where one is strong Christian, and then it goes up to seven where it's strong atheist.
Right.
You know, absolutely
right.
convinced. Right. And he puts himself in category six.
Right.
Saying, you know, I'm fairly convinced there is no God, but I could be wrong.
Yeah.
And I'm pleased to be in Richard Dawkins' camp on that one.
Yeah. Can I ask,
would you guys both say that you're both weak atheists based on what you just said?
Well, here's how I would...
I'm okay with it.
Yeah. Well, I would say this. In a general sense, I would describe myself... When defending atheism, I will take the weak atheist position, like on this program, because I think it is sufficient to defend atheism. Depending on the sort of God I am presented with, and remember, I've said several times on this show, we can only respond to the claims we get from theists, right? So if a theist, or we'll say theist in general sense, some guy who says, oh, well, I worship the sun is my God, right? Okay, well, I can look at that and I can say, all right, well, there's the sun, right? So it pretty clearly exists. So in that regard, I might be borderline theist in regards to the existence of that God. Now, I may disagree with the sun worshiper that the sun is in any way divine or worthy of being worshipped, but I can at least look up and say, yeah, well, it's up there. If I get a definition of a God, let's say the Christian God, who is defined in internally contradictory ways. For example, well, he's both omniscient and omnipotent, which don't work together. Not only do those two things not work together, but omnipotence contradicts itself. So anything that contains an internal contradiction cannot exist. QED, the Christian God, does not exist. So where the Christian God is concerned, I'm a strong atheist. But if you want to talk about Aristotle's, you know, vague prime mover or what have you, I would be a weak atheist in terms of, or the deistic God or what have you. I'd be, or some other sort of definition of God that does not necessarily contain all these internally contradictory elements, then yeah.
Yeah, and I would say...
I talked over you there for a second, and what did you ask me? I'm sorry.
Oh, I just asked whether you were saying that it really depends on your definition of God, right? Whether you're strong or weak.
Yeah, sure. Fair enough.
Yeah. I was having a conversation at a Center for Inquiry meeting here in Tampa on Saturday, and we were talking about the definitions of atheism and agnosticism. Mm-hmm. And when we asked each other, where do you all stand? I think there was pretty much a consensus that everyone thought the most intellectually honest answer in the general term of God and the existence of God was a weak atheistic stance rather than a strong atheistic stance.
Okay, well, hope we helped. We got 3 minutes left, and both these calls on the line look like I ought to get to them.
Thank you, Jason.
Thanks for calling, and I'm going to have to ask that both Mark and George be pretty quick about their business. Mark in Round Rock, what's up?
Hey, I'll be real quick. Hi, my name is Mark. I've been an atheist for about 10 years, and I just want to let you guys know, and maybe your viewers know, that some of us atheists have gotten together, including Mr. Taylor and Joe Semecki, who used to be there on the show, to work together to start the Atheist Helping the Homeless.
Does this group have a website?
Actually, yeah. You can either go to just YouTube and just Atheist Helping the Homeless, and then he's worked with Brian Sapient to get up a website, and I apologize. I can't remember that one off the top of my head.
Fair enough. Well, maybe
those are all fine people.
Yeah, great. Well, we'll tell you what to do. As soon as you get some more detailed information about that, email it to the TV show email, and we'll do a blog entry about it because we got a pretty big, busy blog, and that can be a way to let people know. Okay.
Fair enough. Thanks for getting me in.
Thank you.
Atheistexperience.blogspot.com.
Right on.
Thanks for calling, and this is going to be our last caller today.
Yeah.
George in Greece, the actual Greece. Is that
yes,
you? Yes.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. We don't have much time, George, so...
Yeah. No, basically, I'm going to be quick. It's regarding, I'm going to bring up what God went on you.
Uh-huh.
It's you hear a lot of people talking about how Hitler was an atheist and all that stuff. But if you actually look at the way it's all done, spiritual beliefs in Germany were more like... different, like, and I can't really explain it right now. It's going to take too much time. Mm-hmm. No, I think we better cut it down. Well, have a good week, guys.
Oh, thanks. Okay. Thanks a lot. Sorry.
Thanks.
We had to keep it so short.
Email tv@atheist-community.org if you didn't get on today.
Yeah.
That's our crew, and it looks
our awesome crew.
Our
there
our
they are.
Awesome crew.
And I'm pointing the wrong way.
We got the modifier.
Yes, there. Hi, guys.
Oh, that's
hi,
our
gang.
Awesome
hi, Shelly. Hey,
look
everybody.
Look at those people.
Yes.
They don't stay on screen long enough, but hey. We'll see you at Thread Gills, everybody. And
this had better be good, Russell. Yeah. I'm telling you.
Thanks for making this a great show. bye, everyone.
Well, should we do our old sign off?
Yep. Love rings?
Yeah.
There aren't any.
Yes. And Brian Stieksma is our man.